Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. This is Dr. Shahana, and today we are starting another topic that related to the endocrinology. Another hormone that are mainly we have to learn that is the estrogen, progesterone, and the testosterone. So mainly reproductive side is left. So we are now trying to cover it. What is the diseases that are related to the these hormones? These are some diseases like premenstrual syndrome, like prostatitis, like benign prostate hyperplasia. So we will cover in this section. What is menstruation? It is a normal physiological event that is leading to the start of the bleeding after the age of the 12.5. Most of the time, the age is about 12.5 years. However, early menarche is also possible. That is due to the changing in the nutritional condition of the body and the body weight of the body. It may lead to the earlier onset of the menses. And this earlier onset of the menses is basically due to the pulsatile release of the gonadotropin hormone before the age. Early menarche is not a good condition. It may lead to the, it may predispose the woman to certain types of disorders in later of life. These may be a cancer, these may be a diabetes, or these may be some psychological events. So the good age will be the after 13. However, from the age of 11 to 15, usually the menses are onset. What are the hormonal event during the menstruation cycle? It is a 30-day or 28-day cycle, in which during first half of the cycle is considered as the follicular phase. You can see that this phase is the follicular phase. While in this phase, the endometrium usually thickens under the influence of the increasing level of the estrogen. At that point, the levels of estrogen are continuously increasing. You can see that this pink line is of estrogen here. It will go to increase, and then it is maximum at that point. From where it is secreted? It is basically released from the ovarian follicles. Once the critical point of the estrogen is achieved, at that point, the positive feedbacks, the anterior pituitary gland, it causes the release of the luteinizing surge. Then you can see that after the peak of the estrogen, there is another peak of the luteinizing hormone. Up to 50 international unit of the hormone is released from the anterior pituitary gland. And after 30 to 36 hours, the ovulation will occur in response of this luteinizing hormone peak. After the ovulation, then there is another 14-day cycle, during which the endothelium begins to respond to increasing levels of the progesterone. It gets thickens. At that point, both progesterone and estrogens are secreted from the corpus luteum, that is formed from the remaining of the ovarian follicles after the ovulation. So basically, corpus luteum is there, that is mainly responsible of the now concentration of the estrogen and the progesterone. Lifespan of the corpus luteum is constant, that is about the 14 days. So, progesterone has a thermogenic effect on the hypothalamus, and it increases the basal body weight up to 1 degree Celsius in the second half of the menstruation cycle. And then, after that, if fertilization is not occur, then the effects are declined and there will be the release of the ova from the body, and it doesn't implant in the uterus, led to the shedding of the endometrial layers. That is the start of the menstruation. Most of the ovulatory cycles is of the duration of the 21 to 34 days. After 1 week of the ovulation, that is the 14 day, after 1 week there is a 22 day, it is a 22nd day, the endometrium is prepared for the implantation and providing a way of the fertilization. Usually, if the fertilization is take place, then the endometrium continues to thicken and thicken. If the conception does not occur, then lytolysis begins and the steroidal levels falls. This means that now endometrium cannot be maintained and there is a loss of the stromal liquid. There will be a leukocyte infiltration begins and there is the extravasation of the blood. Finally, endometrium blood loss is reduced and this lead to the necrosis and sloughing, that is the menstruation. This process is have immense concentration of the prostaglandins and inflammatory mediators. Why menstruation are painful? Because some mediators are involved, like arachidonic acid is involved, like nitric oxide is involved in the initiation, and myometrium is the muscular layer of the uterus that contracts spontaneously during the menstruation that lead to the pain. Secondly, both myometrium and endometrium secretes prostaglandins. These prostaglandins have a potential role as an autocoid. Furthermore, there are several types of leukotrienes that are there for the regulation of the uterine functions. They are synthesized from the same arachidonic acid by lipoxygenase pathway. So both mediators lead to the severe type of the pain after the menstruation. Due to this reason, NSAIDs are reserved for the management of these types of the events. Mainly menstruation have a several disorders are there that are associated with the menstruation. Majorly, they have a social problem for the women, and they mainly have a very great impact on their lives. Premenstrual syndrome is a type of disorder that women face, in which some symptoms are occur that encompasses both mood change and the physical symptoms. These symptoms may start even 14 days before the menstruation, or may occur just a few days before the menstruation, and they will disappear after the onset or shortly after the menstruation. In some women, these symptoms are not resolved and they are continuously facing these symptoms. They lead to the continuous stress to the women, and they continuously causing the tiredness. How it can be differentiated? Because if there is no any other sign of the distress or any psychological problem that lead to the changing in the behavior of a woman, then it may be related to the problem regarding its menstruation cycle. Another type of premenstrual syndrome is of the severe type, which is referred as the premenstrual dysphoric disorder. That is diagnosed according to the DSM-5 manual, psychiatric manual. This is one of the drastic mood swings, having a very vigorous anger, depression, irritability, tension, and there will be a change in the sleep and appetite pattern, continuous fatigue, there may be a severe pain and bloating. And the symptoms generally begin the week before the menstruation and ends after the menstruation had begun. And here the treatment involves the use of the antidepressant, especially SSRIs. There is a particular diagnostic criteria that is mentioned in the next slide. According to DSM-5, for that diagnosis of the premenstrual dysphoric disorder, 1 year duration is essential, that a person is facing or present the symptoms. What are these symptoms? We have the criteria A, and 5 of these symptoms at least are present, that is marked with the steric. That is, there will be a very liability of the mood swings, very much irritability or anger, markedly depressed mood, markedly anxiety and tension. At least these symptoms should be present, must during the occur, then the person is considered as the patient of the premenstrual dysphoric disorder. Rest of the symptoms may be there or sometime may not be there. If it is the simplest premenstrual syndrome, then any one of the symptoms is present. While for the premenstrual dysphoric disorder, at least 5 symptoms among below should be mentioned, with at least 1 symptoms that mark with an asterisk should be present. So we can able to differentiate between the premenstrual syndrome and the premenstrual dysphoric disorder. Here the duration of the symptoms is the occurrence of the symptom between 2 cycles of the prospective recordings, while in case of the dysphoric disorder at least 1 year persistent symptoms should be present. One must remember that there is a considerable overlap between the premenstrual syndrome and the premenstrual dysphoric disorder. But the difference is that in case of premenstrual syndrome, usually SSRIs are not prescribed. However, in case of premenstrual dysphoric disorder, SSRIs are the mainstay of the treatment. Furthermore, certain events are linked with the onset of the premenstrual syndrome, like it may be a childbirth after the baby. After the birth of the children, usually the women suffer from the premenstrual syndrome. There may be a cessation of the oral contraceptives. Furthermore, if the patient is suffering from the sterilization or infertility or hysterectomy was performed, or even if there is an increased age, it also lead to the induction of the PMS. Furthermore, PMS is exacerbated by other type of the stress, especially those stress that are associated with the family life. The patient if is obese, if the BMI is greater than 30, it is more likely to suffer from the PMS. To summarize the premenstrual dysphoric syndrome, there may be must be 5 or more of the following symptoms should be present. That is the marked depression, marked anxiety, marked affective lability, there may be a marked irritability, decreased interest in the usual activities, difficulty in concentration, lethargy, change in the appetite, disturbance of the sleep, some physical symptoms like breast tenderness, blotting are present. These symptoms are present in the most menstrual cycle during the 1 year. Or in case of PMS, it is at least 2 cycles, as we have discussed. Usually it occurs in the last week before the menses, and it continue up to the few days of the onset of the menses. And there is the marked interference with these work, social activities and relationships. On this basis, we can differentiate the symptoms in 2 categories. One is affective category and another is the somatic category. In affective category, there may be a depression or maybe angry, maybe anxiety, maybe confusion. But in case of the somatic, there will be a changing in the physical characteristic of the patient. Furthermore, premenstrual syndrome is categorized as the primary premenstrual syndrome, in which it is completely resolved when there is an onset of the menstruation, while secondary premenstrual syndrome is considered as the improvement of the symptom following few days of the menstruation. Diagnosis is difficult, and here we have to maintain some types of diaries that is the mentioning of the symptoms during the life, during the menstruation, after the menstruation and before the menstruation. There are certain types of the questionnaire that has to be asked by our physician to diagnose that it is the premenstrual syndrome. There will be a daily recording of the severity of the problems and there will be a premenstrual symptoms screening tool test. So exact diagnosis is very difficult and it takes plenty of time. At least 2 months are required to properly diagnose the premenstrual syndrome. Why this all occur? Pathophysiology. What is the pathophysiology of the premenstrual syndrome? Premenstrual syndrome is not seen before the puberty and it is not seen in the pregnancy. It is not seen even in the postmenopausal women. So, the main cause is the ovarian hormones that are responsible for the induction of these symptoms. The most important is the mineralocorticoid, prolactins, androgens, prostaglandins, endorphins, and other types of nutritional factors like the changing in the levels of the pyridoxin, calcium, and essential fatty acids. There may be a hypoglycemia. As far as if the problem may be related to the CNS that lead to, basically due to the low cerebral blood flow, especially in the temporal lobes, that usually decrease premenstrually. It is always remember that it is not always essential that all types of the hormones are responsible for the induction of PMS. Different etiological factors apply to different women and according to the different emotional circumstances. Sometimes there may be an evidence that due to the family history, the patient is predisposed to the premenstrual dysphoric syndrome. On this basis, we can say that there may be a certain biological factors, there are certain psychological factors, there are certain social and evolutionary factors, and some genetic tendency are also there for the proposed pathophysiology in the premenstrual syndrome. These are the reasons, and these are mainly the biological reasons in which the glucocorticoids and androgens are the most common reason. Exact explanation is very difficult, but the main problem is that there is an imbalance of the hormone of the progesterone and estradiol. As we have discussed that at ovulation stage, there is a peak of the estradiol and the luteinizing hormone, but there is a deficiency of the progesterone at this level. So it may lead to the imbalance of the hormone. However, it is not directly clinical evidence to support in terms of the serum progesterone level. However, the problem may lie at the cellular level that cannot be easily diagnosed. Or it may be a central control defect because of the ovarian suppression of the gonadotropin releasing hormone analogs. At this level, the use of drug is not recommended because it may disrupt the whole cycle. Still, the research is in continuation, but basically, we are going to have certain modulators that act on the progesterone receptors. Estradiol basically increases the neuronal excitations, possibly due to the activity of the glutamate, an important excitatory amine neurotransmitter. Progesterone and its metabolites bind to the GABA receptors and they mainly give an interaction that induces the similar effect that evoked by the benzodiazepines. The mineralocorticoids, aldosterones, they are mainly associated with the fluid retention because serum level of these hormones are elevated in the luteal phase. However, this was is not actually occurred in some patient. Sometimes it may be not occur in sufferers, or sometimes it may occur in non-sufferers. So, exact reason is not there. Then why this all happens? Prolactin is secreting from the deciduous cells at the end of the luteal phase of the menstruation. It also secreted from the anterior pituitary gland, and this hormone has a direct effect on the breast tissue. It is mainly related to the breast tenderness. Prolactin is also associated with the stress and has an indirect relationship with the dopamine metabolism, and it releases in the CNS. It promotes sodium, potassium and water retention. Again, exact difference is not found in the hormonal blood levels in the PMS sufferers and non-sufferers. Maybe the difference could lie at the receptor level. The most dramatic role is being played by the prostaglandin, that is very clear. Because of their excessive synthesis, they may affect the person. There may be an imbalance in PMS, there may be increased synthesis, especially prostaglandin E2 has an antidiuretic and has a central sedative effect. It promotes the capillary permeability and it promotes the vasodilation. Furthermore, the deficiency of prostaglandin E1 can attenuate some action of the prolactin. So there may be a prolactin hypersensitivity. There may be a role of the vitamin and the minerals, like pyridoxin phosphate is a cofactor of for the number of enzyme reactions, especially that leading to the production of the dopamine and serotonin, that is 5-hydroxytryptamine. And it may be that estrogen and progesterone imbalance may be due to the deficiency of the pyridoxin. Here we have to give the supplementation of this vitamin, and it may, in clinical trial, it shows the reduction in the depression, especially associated with the contraceptive pills. The women that are taking contraceptive pills, if they are taking pyridoxin tablets, their depression will be decreased. Furthermore, decreased dopamine levels will tend to increase the prolactin levels and decrease the serotonin levels. That could be a factor that lead to the emotional disturbance, especially depression. So we can say that premenstrual mood changes are mainly linked to the cycle related alteration in the serotonin activity within the CNS. So serotonin may be the important factor, important neurotransmitter in the pathogenesis of the premenstrual syndrome. Other minerals that may play a role in the premenstrual syndrome are the calcium and the vitamin D. The hydrolyzation of the 25-hydroxy vitamin D3 will take place in the target tissue, which include the breast and the endometrium. And those persons that are women that are taking the vitamin D, it also reduces the risk of the premenstrual syndrome almost a third. Estrogen influences the calcium metabolism, and it basically causing the intestinal absorption as well as the parathyroid gene expression. So there is a fluctuation throughout the menstrual cycles, and disruption of the calcium hemostasis has been associated with the premenstrual syndrome. There are certain essential fatty acids also, such as linoleic acid. They provide a substrate for the prostaglandin synthesis. So linoleic acid is converted into dihomogammalinolenic acid that form the starting point of the synthesis of the prostaglandin series of the prostaglandin E1. Those women that are of PMS symptoms, they are abnormally sensitive to the normal levels of the prolactin. They may be prostaglandin E1 is able to attenuate the biological effect of this hormone. Hence, if there is a deficiency of the linoleic fatty acid, it will be lead to the less production of the prostaglandin E1 synthesis. Therefore, the effect of prolactin with the breast and fluid retention and mood disturbance may be exacerbated because of the decrease in function of the prostaglandin E1 synthesis. Decrease E1 synthesis is due to the deficiency of essential fatty acids. There are numerous other dietary factors that are involved. For example, there may be the intake of the excess of saturated fatty acids and the cholesterol. There may be consumption of the alcohol. There may be zinc and magnesium deficiencies. There may be diabetes. There may be age, or there may be other infections like viral infections that hinder the conversion of the cis linoleic acid to the gamma linoleic acid. Gamma linoleic acid is mainly important for the women. Pyridoxine, ascorbic acid, and niacin and vitamin A, they increases the conversion of the gamma linoleic acid to the prostaglandin E1. So in short, we can say that the etiology of the premenstrual syndrome is very complicated. The major linking neurotransmitter is the serotonin. And if there is a problem in the serotonin, there will be a lower platelet concentration, there will be a lower luteal phase levels, there may be enhanced sensitivity to the progesterones, there will be levels elevated by the estradiols, and here we need SSRIs for its proper management. GABA is a very important inhibitory neurotransmitter of the CNS, and the low levels of the GABA, it may lead to the mood disorders. Another neurotransmitter is the allopregnanolone. It is the metabolite of the progesterone. It is a potent neurotransmitter. If it is a high level, it may cause the anxiolytic effects. If it is a low level, it decreases the emotional lability. It is low in the follicular and luteal phase, and it causes the impaired response due to the change in the gonadotropin releasing hormone or ACTH stimulation. It may impair the stereogenesis by the corpus luteum. So it may lead to the estrogen responsive depressive disorders like postnatal depression, premenstrual depression, and the climactic depressions. These are the treatment options for the management of the premenstrual syndromes. They are resolving the premenstrual syndrome, as we can compare it with the deficiency or imbalance when we have discussed in the biological levels. So we may have certain drugs that can use effectively for the management of the premenstrual syndrome. Depending upon the condition of a patient, different treatment options are suggested. If it is the mild and moderate premenstrual syndrome, it is managed by changing in the lifestyle by means of the nutrients. The first step in the management of the PMS is the recognition of the problem and the realization that why the women are suffering from the condition. You have to maintain a menstrual diary. You have to establish a link between the symptoms and between the menstruation. That what are the symptoms that are mainly due to the that are present due to the menstruation. It is the cornerstone of the diagnosis. After a few months, it will allow the patient to make the predictions and help her dealing with these changes when they arrive. Self-help is very important, because here the role of the patient is very important. You have to counsel the patient to carefully assess his her condition, as there is a wide variety of the symptoms that need to be explored, or different types of the treatment options. Initially start from the lifestyle modification, then a proper step stress management should be there. We are starting with the mild medications, evening primrose and the diuretics. Then we have to use certain types of mineral supplementations like vitamin B6 supplementation, vitamin A supplementation, vitamin D, magnesium, zinc, calcium levels. If the severity is increasing, then we have to go for the treatment of the moderate type of the treatment plan. Here we have to adapt the SSRIs and we have to adapt the progesterone supplements. So in case of the psychological management, we have to either choose SSRIs or SNRIs, or we have to differentiate the symptoms that are mainly due to either progesterone or due to the estradiol. Depending upon the reason, we have to add a gonadotropin releasing hormone analog. Especially if the person is resistant to the previous monotherapy of either progesterone or estradiol, combined oral contraceptive pills were initially designed by the Graham in 1992. They have a little benefit, but they are mainly responsible for the suppression of the ovulation. There may be a progesterone premenstrual syndrome like side effects are also there, and there will be a pill-free week. There may be a role of the progestin, and synthetic progestins are also available, such as like previously progesterone was a drug of choice. However, due to the lack of the evidence and due to several side effects, now it is not longer recommended. Why there are too much side effects? Because of the affinity like mineralocorticoids activity and for the androgenic receptors activity. Now they are not used. However, third generation progesterones that have an ethyl group at C13 like gestodine, degosterol and norgestimate, they have been least androgenic activity and they may they are still orally active. So this treatment may be given with 2 or 3 menstrual cycle, either with combination product or there will be a mono product, monotherapy with progesterone. However, if there is a breakthrough bleeding, BTB, then these should be stopped. This bleeding refers to the bleeding that occur either as a spotting between a non-menstrual period or when a person is pregnant and they are maintained on these therapies. It mainly decreases the patient compliance. Some clinical trial recommend the use of the ES, that is the oral combined oral contraceptive pills. Here, researchers found about 48% reduction in the symptoms of the premenstrual syndrome. Another treatment approach is to use of the estradiol patches, and the results of this activity was shown that there is a mass gradual reduction in the symptoms of the mood swings when there will be a placebo-active combination was given. Usually it takes about 6 months of the therapy. The dose is the 100 microgram patches that was tried. Low dose therapy. The dose may be high up to 200 microgram, but the benefit is not proven. So we have to avoid the higher doses, that is 200 microgram. We can't use, we have to use the lower doses for that purpose. The main treatment is the use of the antidepressant, but the problem is that the antidepressant have the dependency. Basically, they are meant for the reduction of the depression. They basically, the SSRIs increases the allopregnanolone levels that enhances the GABA function. Now they are the most popular and the treatment of choice for PMS, as they are also cope up the symptoms of the depression and also well tolerated. And the choices are the fluoxetine, sertraline and citalopram, fluvoxamine and paroxetine. Now they are considered as a first effective line of therapy, first line of therapy for the severe premenstrual syndromes. Common side effects of our experience, normally these are headaches, nervousness, drowsiness and fatigue. The most problematic side effect is the sexual dysfunction and the GI disturbance. However, these could be continued across the cycle, or they may be restricted only to the luteal phase that may reduce the symptoms of the premenstrual syndrome. These dose-dependent side effects are some common like nausea and asthenia. Saint-Jean-Bon has been used to reduce the premenstrual syndrome, but now Saint-Jean-Bon is not used due to the different types of side effects. Other agents like tricyclic antidepressants and anxiolytics like buspirone and other types of anxiolytics can also be used, but their efficacy is less as compared to SSRIs. Several clinical trials were reported, like they are useful for the premenstrual dysphoria. They are reducing the tension and irritability. For example, fluoxetine is very effective in the luteal phase. Side effects are very minimum. Citalopram 10 to 20 mg is supposed to be active in the luteal phase. They are reserved for the mild SSRI therapy. Some other drugs are there that have an effect on the prolactin, that is the bromocriptan, that mainly stimulates the central dopamine receptor. In turn, indirectly it inhibits the release of prolactin. Bromocriptan is mainly used for the symptoms of the hyperprolactinemia, and this condition is associated with basically the several types of disorders, including the lack of menstrual periods. There may be a discharge from the nipples. There may be an infertility that the patient become difficult to become pregnant. There may be a hypogonadism. For that purpose, bromocriptan is a drug of choice. Furthermore, there are certain prolactin secreting tumors here where the levels of prolactin are high. Here the bromocriptan is useful. It shrinks the tumors. Furthermore, they are also used for the acromegaly and the Parkinson's disease. Bromocriptan is unique in that scenario that it doesn't have specific receptors that mediate its action on the glucose and lipid metabolism. Rather, its effects are mediated via resetting the dopaminergic and sympathetic tone within the CNS, and the time of administration is very important, especially if it is taken in early morning. It increases the hypothalamic and the dopaminergic levels, that in turn decrease the sympathetic nervous activity, decrease HGP, decrease lipolysis, increase glucose intolerance. If it is not taken in early morning, it decreases the hypothalamic dopamine levels in the diabetes. So the several drug-drug interactions in which the problem related to diabetes is also present, that it may lead to the glucose intolerance. It may lead to the insulin resistance, it may lead to dyslipidemia, and increase lead to the cardiovascular diseases if it is taken wrongly. Other mild side effects are also there, that are tiredness, dizziness, drowsiness, difficulty in sleeping, depression. Some serious side effects are also there, like fainting, watery discharge from the nose, numbness, blood vomiting, swelling of feet, seizures, difficulty in speech, blood vomiting. Due to these side effects, the physician should consider that why bromocriptan is taken instead of the SSRIs. Simply, one can use certain types of the prostaglandin synthesis inhibitors like mefenamic acid. Most effective in the uterus, endometrium and myometrium. Mefenamic acid at the dosage of 250 mg 3 times a day for the period of 12 days before a period started, with the increment to up to 500 mg 3 times a day for a 9 days total duration, can be prescribed unless and until the third day of the menstruation if the symptoms are very severe. As the duration is very short, most of the patients are not suffering from the symptoms of the gastric ulcer and the renal compromise function of the NSAIDs. Other COX inhibitors can also be suggested. But here the mefenamic acid is a drug of choice because it is also an antagonist at the prostaglandin E receptor, besides its the inhibition of the synthesis of the prostaglandins by inhibition of the enzyme COX. So ideally, it should be prescribed 24 hours before the onset of the symptoms. If we compare the SSRIs with mefenamic acid, as the mefenamic acid is very easy to take, there are not any other side effects like suicidal attempts when we have to withdraw the mefenamic acid as compared to SSRIs. So it is preferred over the SSRIs due to its easy withdrawal effects. कि ये आराम से छोड़ सकते हैं as compared to SSRIs, वो फिर हम अगर हम उनको stop करनी है तो फिर हम उसको फौरन वैसे नहीं छोड़ सकते. इसलिए mefenamic acid in second scenario consider as a most prescribed drug in PMS. Gonadotropin releasing hormone analogs, they are also effective in the management of the PMS, but the problem is that they are only reserved for the physical symptoms. They are less effective with respect to the emotional symptoms. These agents inhibit the hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis. They are unsuitable for the long-term use alone, and this hormone replacement therapy adds back to prevent the menopausal symptoms and the bone loss. Their use is not recommended for more than 6 months because they induce the hypoestrogenic activity, they causing the significant bone loss. In future aims, one can consider as the combined oral contraceptive as a first choice for the management of the premenstrual syndrome. However, at this level, now it is not considered as a first choice. This exogenous estrogen may be contraindicated because of the increases of the venous thromboembolism. This combination, yes, is the combination of the two hormones, that is the estrogen, that is the estradiol, and the progesterone in the form of the drospirenone. This product is mainly used for the prevention of the pregnancy by preventing the release of an egg during your menstruation cycle. Mainly, this product is reserved for the management of the PMS that do not want to be pregnant, as it inhibits the ovulation. The administration is very important because the time of administration should be mimic the normal function in such a way that it inhibits the ovulation and inhibits the luteinizing surge. The product get with a specific marking that which date you have to take the waste drug so that it inhibits the ovulation. The problem is that yes, there are too much side effects like nausea, vomiting, headache, bloating, breast tenderness, swelling of the ankles, weight changes may occur, bleeding between the periods, which is the breakthrough bleedings. There may be irregular menstruations. More severe side effects including the increasement in the blood pressure, symptoms of the high potassium blood levels, there may be muscle weakness, there may be a slow or irregular heartbeat, there may be a formation of blood clot in the veins, in the arteries, there may be a thromboembolic event, there may be a pulmonary embolism, there may be a deep vein thrombosis, there may be stroke, there may be heart attack. It can precipitate the onset of the heart failure, like there may be sudden shortness of breath, SOB, there may be chest tightness, unusual sweating, confusion, coughing up of blood, pain, swelling, numbness, there may be a migraine, headaches, and there may be a worsening of the migraine, there may be a trouble in speaking. So these drugs are not safe, and even these may causing alarm in the breast, they may be a carcinogenic, there may be a severe stomach abnormal pain, dark urine. There may be a worsening of the depression and the suicidal thoughts. So, in short, we have to train the health professionals and we have to take certain preventions that we can easily manage the patient with the normal non-pharmacological means. This is all about the premenstrual syndrome. Its summary will be shared separately. Thank you.